Assalamu alaikum, good morning everyone. I am Akram Mohammed Ahmed, resident urology. Today I am presenting understanding clinical variable to improve empirical antibiotic therapy for urinary tract infection. Basically, this is a review article published in Nature Review of Urology in December 2019. So, the purpose of this article is a recent study show a correlation between clinical patient feature and antibiotic resistance in patient with urinary tract infection. As resistance to antibiotic cannot be reversed, managing its emergencies is of the utmost importance. Improving surveillance data will enable selection of appropriate antibiotic and help reduce the development of resistance. So before going to this article, first, some introduction about urinary tract infection. So this is an outline of this presentation, that is definition and classification, epidemiology, pathogenesis, diagnosis, and we will also discuss the treatment guidelines. So urinary tract infection by definition is symptomatic urothelial inflammation secondary to bacterial adherence and internalization within urinary tract. So the typical symptoms are frequency, urgency, dysuria, suprapubic pain in case of lower urinary tract infection, and flank pain and fever in case of upper urinary tract. So to meet the criteria, definition criteria, patient need to have positive urine culture. The traditional cutoff value is 10 to the 5 coliformin unit per ml. Or in symptomatic patient, the lower cutoff value is 10 to the 2 coliformin unit per ml we can use. So in contrast of this, asymptomatic bacteria urea is 2 consecutive midstream urine specimen with isolation of the same bacterial strain in the quantitative count more than 10 to the 5 coliformin unit per ml. As the name shows, there is absence of the symptoms. So what is pyuria? Pyuria is the presence of white blood cells in the urine is generally indicative of infection and inflammation response of the urothelium to the bacterium, stone or other indwelling foreign bodies. Bacteria without pyuria is generally indicative of bacterial colonization without infection of the urinary tract. But pyuria without bacteriuria wants evolution for tuberculosis, stones or cancer. So we can classify urinary tract infection on the basis of anatomical and degree of complexity. On the anatomical basis, we can classify into lower urinary tract infection, which is bladder or urethra, and upper urinary tract infection, which is kidney and ureter. On the basis of complexity, there is uncomplicated and complicated urinary tract infection. Uncomplicated urinary tract infection is described an infection in a healthy patient with a structurally and functionally normal urinary tract. In complicated urinary tract infection, infection is associated with the factors that increase the chance of acquiring bacteria and decrease the efficacy of therapy. The urinary tract is structurally or functionally abnormal, the host is compromised, and bacteria have increased virulence or antimicrobial resistance. So these are the common risk factors for complicated urinary tract infection. We categorize them in general and neurological form. In general, there is male, gender, children, diabetic patient, pregnancy, immunocompromised patient, renal insufficiency, neurological disease or injury. And urological risk factor is nosocomial infection, foreign bodies like urinary catheter or renal stone, anatomical abnormality, polycystic kidney, diverticuli, vesicoureteric reflex, urinary tract obstruction, renal artery stenosis or thrombosis, voiding dysfunction, surgery of the urinary tract, and antimicrobial resistance. But UTI may also be defined by their relationship to other UTI, that is isolated UTI and recurrent UTI. Isolated UTI is an interval of at least 6 months between the infection. And recurrent UTI is a two culture proven infection within 6 months or more than or three culture proven infection within 12 months. Recurrent UTI may be due to reinfection or persistence. Reinfection is infection by the different bacteria negative culture between the infection or infection occur more than 2 weeks after successful treatment. And persistence urinary tract infection, the infection recurrence is within 2 weeks of the treatment by the same organism originating from a focus within the urinary tract. So moving to epidemiology of the UTI. Urinary tract infection is the most common human bacterial infection. Millions of the patients visit physician clinic and thousands of the patients require hospitalizations annually. Foxman University of Michigan estimated overall expenditure exceed more than 3.5 billion a year. So here the incidence is based on age and sex. Here we can see that multiple uptake in life in female in preschool age may be due to voiding dysfunction, in childbearing age may be due to frequency of intercourse, and in older age due to vaginal epithelium change. And in female only we see in late age due to obstruction, benign prostatic obstruction. So coming to the bacteriology, we can predict uropathogen in uncomplicated and complicated UTI. Here we can see that common uropathogen is E. coli, but in complicated case we change the pattern that here is Candida, Krebsella and Enterococcus are also common pathogen, which may be due to risk factor, enabling catheter and abino compromise, urinary tract abnormalities and antibiotics resistance. So coming to the pathogenesis, there is four common routes of infection. The most majority of the patients are majority of the infections are spread in ascending fashions from extraurinary source such as distal gut or vaginal epithelium. But the three other source of infection are uncommon. The metrogenous spread is in those patients with Streptococcus aureus, Candida and Mycobacterium tuberculosis. And lymphatogenous spread is via rectal, colonic or periuterine lymph nodes. And direct extension from the other organism, intraperitoneal abscess or vesico-intestinal or vesico-vaginal fistula, relapsing infection from an indiscriminately treated focus in the prostate or kidney may seed other parts of the urinary tract. And the host factor and bacterial pathogen factor, which is already discussed in previous lecture in detail. So there is no need for a discussion on this. So coming to the diagnosis, the cornerstone of the diagnosis is the history and a good physical examination. And in on laboratory testing, there is urinalysis, in which we see leukocyte, esterase and nitrates can be detected by urine dipstick and are more reliable when the bacterial count is more than 1 lakh colony forming units. And on microscopic examination, urine for VCN bacteria is performed after centrifugation when bacteria counts are more than 1 lakh colony forming units per ml. If WBC count is more than 3 WBC per high power field suggest a possible infection.
What are the particular points that you need to ask?
Like what?
What are the particular points that you need to ask this? In history, what particular points you need to ask?
We common symptoms and previous antibiotic history, any comorbids, and these are the common
points.
All risk factor we ask in history.
What are the particular points on physical
examination? On physical examination, we should, especially in female patient, we should examine the pelvis and genitalia. And complete genitourinary examination. DRE. DRE. Yes. Valuable bladder. Yes. But in some cases, we not need DRE, like acute bacterial prostatitis. So in laboratory testing, we see four leukocyte stress and nitrates, and on macroscopic examination, we see four. If the WBC count in more than three in high power field, suggest a possible bacterial infection. And coming to the urinary urine culture and sensitivity, which we know is gold standard. It is not necessary in every patient, but we should send urine culture in patient with atypical symptoms, negative urinalysis, recent antibiotic use, and complicated. We should obtain urinary culture. And the cutoff value is 10 to the 5 conforming unit per ml urine is the classic definition of positive urine culture. But in symptomatic patient, the 10 to the 2 conforming unit is we can use. So,
how will you take the urine culture in a patient who has the best price?
We change the catheter first. We change the F or after that, we take urine culture.
Where is it? From bag or something?
No, from tube. If there is no need of urine that catheter, then we remove first catheter, then take sample. So, there is an additional investigation that is upper tract imaging, cystoscopy, urodynamics, which is generally unnecessary during initial diagnostic testing, but indication for additional investigation is complicated urinary tract infection, urinary retention, persistence to viewer, unexplained hematuria, bacterial persistence, suspected renal stones. So, coming to the treatment, antibiotic empirical treatment. Treatment with antimicrobial agent has minimized the morbidity and mortality associated with urinary tract infection. The goal in treatment is to eradicate the infection by selecting the appropriate antibiotic that would target specific bacterial susceptibility. However, choosing the appropriate antimicrobial agent is often difficult. So these are the general principle for selecting the appropriate antibiotic, including consideration of the patient age, gender, pregnancy, or nursing home status, antimicrobial site of infection, whether this is of the infection is of lower urinary tract infection or upper urinary tract infection, community required versus hospital required patients, immunocompetent or immunocompromised patient. We see four susceptibility patterns of potential pathogen in the community or hospital, recent hospitalization, chronic disease. We for recent antibiotic use, travels, and colonization with resistant bacteria, contact with potential resistant bacteria, severity of the infection. In the first dose of antibiotic, that is volume of the antibiotic distribution, body mass, and the dosing interval and maintenance dosing, that we should look for urodynamic and urokinetics, because in some drugs need to adjust in kidney and liver diseases. So coming to the EU guideline on urological infection. So recommendation for asymptomatic bacteria is only two population needs asymptomatic bacteria to screen and test, that is pregnancy and urological procedures, and which is not need to screen, that is women without risk factor, patient with well regulated diabetes mellitus, postmenopausal women, elderly anesthetization patient, patient with dysfunctional or reconstructed lower urinary tract, patient with renal transplant, patient prior to orthoplasty surgery, patient with recurrent urinary tract infection. So coming to the uncomplicated cystitis, first we will discuss uncomplicated cases, then we go for complicated cases. So for uncomplicated cystitis, recommendations are prescribed fosfomycin, first line of drug is fosfomycin, trometramol, pyrimethamine or nitrofurination is a first line treatment for the uncomplicated cystitis in women. Do not use aminopenicillin or fluoroquinolones to treat uncomplicated cystitis. These are the drug regimen which we can adjust according to the local guideline. So recommendation for the diagnostic evaluation and treatment of recurrent UTI. Diagnosis of recurrent UTI is by urine culture. So do not perform an extensive routine workup, example cystoscopy, full abdominal ultrasound in women younger than 40 years of age with recurrent UTI and no risk factors. Advise patient a behavioral modification which might reduce the risk of recurrent UTI. Use vaginal estrogen replacement in patient postmenopausal women to prevent recurrent UTI. As vaginal estrogen reduce innate immunity and restore innate immunity and lactobacilli and growth of the urothelium. Use amino active prophylaxis to reduce recurrent UTI in all age group. Use continuous or post-coital antimicrobial prophylaxis to prevent recurrent UTI when non-antimicrobial intervention have failed. Consult patient regarding possible side effect. For patient with good compliance, self-administered short-term antimicrobial therapy should be considered. So, coming to the uncomplicated pyelonephritis. Uncomplicated pyelonephritis is defined as pyelonephritis limited to non-pregnant premenopausal women with no non-relevant urological abnormalities or comorbidities. So these are the treatment recommendations for uncomplicated pyelonephritis. Treat patient with uncomplicated pyelonephritis not requiring hospitalization with short-term fluoroquinolones as a first-line treatment. Treat patient with uncomplicated pyelonephritis requiring hospitalization with intravenous antimicrobial regimen. Switch patient initially treated with intravenously who improve clinically and can tolerate oral fluid or oral antimicrobial therapy. Do not use nitrofurination, oral fosfomycin to treat the uncomplicated pyelonephritis. So these are the regimen which we can change on local guideline. Coming to the complicated cases, complicated urinary tract infection are believed to result in an infection that will be more difficult to eradicate than in uncomplicated cases. recommendation guidelines for complicated urinary tract infection treatment is use the combination of the amoxicillin plus an aminoglycoside or a second generation cephalosporin plus aminoglycoside or a third generation cephalosporin intravenously as empirical treatment of complicated urinary tract infection with systemic symptoms. But only use ciprofloxacin provided that if the local resistance is less than 10%. When the entire treatment is given orally, patient do not require hospitalization, patient has an anaphylaxis for beta-lactamase antimicrobials. Do not use ciprofloxacin and other furoquinones for the empirical treatment of the complicated urinary tract infection in patient from urology department or when patient have used furoquinones in the last 6 months. Manage any urological abnormalities and underlying complication factor first. So, catheter associated urinary tract infection, which is very common, and this is referred to urinary tract infection occurring in a person whose urinary tract is currently catheterized or has been catheterized within past 48 hours. Do not use pyuria as a sole indicator for catheter associated urinary tract infection. Do not use the presence or absence of cloudy urine alone to differentiate catheter associated asymptomatic bacteriuria from catheter associated UTI. So these are the recommendations for disease management and prevention of catheter associated urinary tract infection. Treat symptomatic urinary tract infection according to the recommendation for complicated UTI. Take a urine culture prior to initiation antimicrobial therapy in catheterized patient in whom the catheter has been removed. Do not treat catheter associated asymptomatic bacteriuria in general. Treat catheter associated asymptomatic bacteriuria prior to traumatic urinary tract intervention like TURP, TURBT. Replace or remove the indwelling catheter before starting antimicrobial therapy. Do not apply topical antiseptic or antimicrobials to the catheter, urethra or meatus. Do not use prophylactic antimicrobials to prevent catheter-associated UTI. The duration of the catheterization should be minimal. So coming to the urosepsis. Urosepsis is life-threatening organ dysfunction caused by a dysregulated host response to infection originating from the urinary tract or male genital organ. Recommendation for the diagnosis and treatment of urosepsis. Perform the quick SOFA score to identify patients with potential sepsis. In quick SOFA score, we see for GCS, respiratory rate, and systolic blood pressure. Take a urine culture and two sets of blood culture before starting antimicrobial treatment. Administer parenteral high dose broad spectrum antimicrobial within the first hour after clinical assumption of sepsis. Adopt initial empiric antimicrobial therapy on the basis of culture result. Initial source control including removal of the foreign bodies, decompression of obstruction and drainage of abscess in the urinary tract. Provide immediate adequate life support measures. And these are the antimicrobial therapy regimen for urosepsis, which we can change according to the local guidelines. So coming to the urethritis, inflammation of the urethra present usually with lower urinary tract symptoms, and we must be distinguished from other infection of the lower urinary tract. So recommendation for diagnostic evaluation and antimicrobial treatment for urethritis is perform a gram stain of urethral discharge or a urethral smear to diagnose gonococcal urethritis. Perform a validated nucleic acid amplification test on a first void urine sample or urethral smear prior to empirical treatment to diagnose chlamydial and gonococcal infection. Delay treatment until the result of the nucleic acid amplification test are available to guide treatment choice in patient with mild symptoms. perform a urethral swab culture prior to initiation of the treatment in patient with a positive NET test for gonorrhea to assess the antimicrobial resistance profile of the infective strains. Use a pathogen directed treatment based on local resistance data. Sexual partners should be treated maintaining patient confidentiality. So coming to the bacterial prostatitis, actually acute, there is two forms, that is acute and chronic bacterial prostatitis, which is very uncommon. But acute bacterial prostatitis is common symptoms are perineal pain, irritative storage, and obstructive voiding symptoms, fever and chill. On physical examination, there is a boggy, hot, tender, or even very hot prostate, very tender prostate. But generally, there is that DRE is not required in acute bacterial, if we suspect that it is acute bacterial prostatitis. So, is other infection, the common uropathogen is E. coli, Enterococcus, and Pseudomonas, Klebsiella, and Enterobacter. So, the risk factor for acute bacterial prostatitis is urinary tract infection, condom or enabling catheter, unprotected penetrative and erectile intercourse, transurethral surgery, prostate biopsy, dysfunctional voiding, that is anatomical or neurophysiological, which interprostatic ductal reflex. Recommendation for the diagnosis of acute bacterial prostatitis: do not perform prostatic massage in acute bacterial prostatitis. Take a midstream urine dipstick to check nitrate and glucoside. Take a midstream urine culture in patient with acute bacterial prostatitis symptoms to guide diagnosis and tailor antibiotic treatment. Take a blood culture and a total blood count in patient presenting with acute bacterial prostatitis. Treatment of acute bacterial prostatitis is the same for recommended for complicated UTI. Chronic bacterial prostatitis is only forming 5-15% of the prostatitis cases. And there is history of more than 3 months for the diagnosis. Important clue on history is asymptomatic between the episodes, although can have chronic pelvic pain syndrome, and history of recurrent UTI, which is in 25-40% patients. On physical examination, unremarkable with the except of pain, DRE only after prostatic massage, urine specimen collected. The recommendation for the diagnosis of chronic bacterial prostatitis is perform accurate microbiological evaluation for atypical pathogens such as chlamydia and mycoplasma in patient with a chronic bacterial prostatitis. Perform the 2 glass or 4 glass test. Perform the transrectal ultrasound in selected cases to rule out the presence of abscess. Do not routinely perform microbiological analysis of the ejaculatory alarm to diagnose chronic bacterial prostatitis. And coming to the treatment of chronic bacterial prostatitis, prescribe of ferloquinolones, that is ciprofloxacin or levofloxacin, as a first-line treatment. Prescribe of macrolides, that is azithromycin or tetracycline, doxycycline, if intracellular bacteria have been identified as the causative agent. Prescribe metronidazole in patient with Trichomonas vaginalis infection in chronic bacterial prostatitis. So these are the regimen which we can change on local guidelines. So coming to the antibiotic prophylaxis for very urological procedure. The standard practice is we should give antibiotic in less than 1 hour prior to incision, or in case of vancomycin, that should be less than 2 hours. If patient is not eligible for antibiotic, then we should document that why not given antibiotic. This is the standard practice. Recommendation for pre-procedure antibiotic prophylaxis. Do not use antibiotic prophylaxis to reduce the rate of asymptomatic urinary infection forming urodynamic cystoscopy, extracorporeal shock wave lithotripsy, that is ESWL. Use antibiotic prophylaxis to reduce the rate of symptomatic urinary tract infection following urethroscopy. And in percutaneous nephrolithotomy, we use single dose antibiotic. Use antibiotic prophylaxis to reduce infection complication in men undergoing TURP or high risk patient with undergoing TURBT. Use local pyridine, iodine, and T-micropyl prophylaxis in men prior to transrectal prostate biopsy. So, coming to the article, this is published in Nature Review Urology in December 2019. This is basically a review article. And the title is Understanding Clinical Variable to Improve Empirical Antibiotic Therapy for Urinary Tract Infection. Elam and colleagues exploit a large database from the Mikobi Healthcare Services, which is Israel's second largest health maintenance organization. They retrospectively retrieved data set of Mauer for 7 lakh positive urine culture from over 3 lakh patients with UTI and 5 million individually resolved record of antibiotic purchases and presented very detailed data on antibiotic consumption, reporting a link between the antibiotic resistance and antibiotic consumption on the individual patient level. The major clinical demographic data included factors associated with antimicrobial resistance such as age, gender, pregnancy or nursing home status. But not type of the urinary tract infection or presence of the typical risk factor, which is the weaknesses of this study. Nevertheless, it did reveal interesting result regarding these assessed factors in previous antibiotic consumption, finding strong drug-specific associated with resistance. By analyzing same patient peer urine sample, they showed a significant long-term correlation between these factors and resistance against all 6 antibiotic tested, which lasted longer than 6 months for most antibiotic, even exceeded 1 year for ciprofloxacin. So the risk of resistance strongly increased with age and with retirement home residence, and decreased for female 6 and pregnancy. The elevated risk of developing antibiotic-resistant UTI decayed slowly after 6 to 12 months but remained elevated throughout the 10-year surveillance period of the study, representing permanent patient-specific tendencies toward resistance. In other words, the burden of the antimicrobial resistance we continuously produce will remain and continue to be a burden for future generations. Then the author used machine learning program with algorithmic approaches to improve appropriate antibiotic treatment by inputting the retrospectively evaluated data associated with antibiotic resistance. These approaches decrease inappropriate antibiotic treatment from 8.5% to 5.1%. But a rate of 8.5% is inappropriate empirical antibiotic treatment was lower than reported in other studies, in which rates ranges from 35% to 57% in complicated UTI. One explanation for this low rate could be that this study included fewer patients with complicated or healthcare associated UTI. So, coming to the discussion, antibiotic treatment is frequently performed empirically, but traditional culture-based antimicrobial resistant testing can take a minimum of 48 hours, which can be too long in patients who need immediate treatment for the severity of their infection, or when other mainly organizational reasons necessitate physicians to treat patients quickly. Empirical antibiotic treatment has two important drawbacks. First, the infecting agent might not be susceptible to the antibiotic administered administered leading to treatment failure. And second drawback is when treating empirically, physicians tend to prescribe broad spectrum and less resolved antibiotics in order to minimize treatment failure, which in turn increase antibiotic selection pressure, deriving antibiotic resistance. Thus, improving empirical antibiotic treatment is extremely important to improve patient care and antimicrobial stewardship. One way to improve the choice of the right antibiotic is to include detailed clinical information on patient demographic, comorbidities, hospitalization, resistance of previous infection, and the type of urinary tract infection, including risk factor for recurrent UTI. Ilian and colleagues have shown that adding individual clinical information to the microbiological information on antibiotic resistance improves prediction of antimicrobial resistance and translates into a reduction in the inappropriate treatment. If more clinical information on the type of UTI are present or absence of risk factor, for example, presence of urinary catheter morbidity, comorbidity, or previous surgery had been included, an even better prediction of antimicrobial resistance might have been achieved. The clinical information is important for every type of resistance statistics. One international prevalence study on the urological infection that showed resistance rate in a urosepsis was significantly higher in other clinical diagnoses of healthcare-associated urinary tract infection, also demonstrated that every additional piece of clinical information made available could improve the prediction of antimicrobial resistance and therefore improve appropriate empiric therapy. Different approaches to improve surveillance data have been used to improve empirical therapy, for example, computerized decision support system or weighted incidence syndromic combination interbiogram method and microbiological point of care testing tools. Microbiological point of care testing tools, which have been implemented to some extent in primary care setting, techniques to confirm the presence or absence of bacteria or even the type of bacteria present have now been implemented in many areas of the medicine and modern diagnostic method for urinary tract infection are increasingly focused on point of care scenarios. However, these approaches are now of limited value owing to the increased level of antibiotic resistance in almost all bacteria species. The evaluation of these approaches is required to enable point of care susceptibility testing. If susceptibility results were routinely available within 2 hours of the testing, many issues associated with antibiotic resistance would be omitted. So, coming to the conclusion of the article, antibiotic treatment would only be started in patients with a demonstrated bacterial infection. The prescribed antibiotic treatment would be appropriate to the specific organism and antimicrobial stewardship could be immediately included in the primary treatment regimen, or with selecting antibiotic with low rate of collateral adverse effect. Various clinical data are associated with antimicrobial resistance, and this should be routinely included in antimicrobial surveillance system. Resistance one emerge does not return to baseline level even if the selective pressure is withdrawn, leading to a continuously increased antimicrobial resistance burden. So the traditional reporting of antimicrobial resistance with only descriptively listed retrospective information could be considerably improved by using mathematical modeling algorithmic such as the computerized decision system or the Weskov method. The clinical application of such algorithmic could help improve the appropriateness of the antimicrobial treatment and therefore reduce treatment failure and improve antimicrobial stewardship. So the take home message is straightforward: when prescribing antibiotics, start smart, then focus on use the right drug at the right time, at the right dose for the right duration. In this way, we might be able to preserve the utility of antibiotics. Thank you so much.